pathway announced an opportunity that would facilitate the sending of over 1,000 youths to the Gulf nations to work as drivers, waiters, waitresses, and of course in other sectors such as the construction sector on a salary range of 10 to 15,000 kwacha. Now, the announcement did trigger diverse views from different stakeholders, and today on the program, we will be hearing from an expert from the Zambia Institute for Policy Analysis and Research, who has done some extensive research on the Zambian labor market. And of course, this is no other than Mr. Felix Mwenge.
Sure, thanks.
Okay, so now to just kickstart this conversation, we know that, you know, when this announcement was made, there was a huge uproar, you know, and of course, people did air sentiments that were pro and some against. As an expert, what is your view on this matter?
Gwenson, thank you so much. let me just begin by clarifying also that the sentiments were largely on social media. Exactly. So you because we are privileged this time around to have access to Facebook and you see a lot of views going on and about. Coming to the topic, I would like us to actually be very clear from the start. This issue is not about what's bad and what's good. It's actually about you know, understanding what this is about and also striking a balance, sending people to the Gulf region. What is this about and what's good in it? And also thinking that we have a government which I think is a responsible government, which wouldn't want to send somebody to go and die. So it's basically the discussion should be around trying to look at both angles of the situation. We should also remind ourselves that you know, Zambians have always been working abroad. If you can remember in the 1980s, who was the 1980s? We had a lot of our teachers going to teach in places like Botswana, Namibia, and South Africa, and you know, sending help back home. So whether this is bad or good, really we need to be careful and just speak on both sides. What seems to be the biggest concern, which I'm also concerned about, is that you know, there's been abuses reported in that region from actually, you know, good standing institutions like the BBC, Amnesty International, and the Human Rights Watch. So as much as there are opportunities for jobs, there's actually a concern in terms of the abuses that people undergo there. So when we have a discussion, we actually have to balance, you know, what's good in this, and if there are abuses, is there a way of mitigating those?
Okay. 0974754719 is the number that you simply have to call to be part and parcel of this particular discussion. Remember, this opportunity is for every Zambian. It could be your opportunity, it could be your relative that may decide to actually take this opportunity up. Therefore, it would be pertinent that we get to hear from you. Now, you did mention something worthwhile, saying this is not the first time that, yes, Zambia is actually sending, you know, or exporting labor, you know, in various fields, okay, to, you know, nations, you know, surrounding nations, and of course, overseas, you know, and it's not a phenomenon that should really, you know, cause such an uproar as if it is happening for the first time. But following, you know, the documentary that you did cite, I actually had an opportunity to also look at it and, you know, did a little bit of a digging further, and I discovered that there is a system that is known as the kafala, or in English, you would simply call it the sponsorship system, okay, sure, which reduces the rights of migrant workers in domestic sectors. The system also has been criticized by the institution that you did refer to, the Amnesty International, human rights agencies, for making it easy in those particular regions to exploit the workers, okay? So are there modalities to protect the Zambian youths that are watching us right now that may decide to take up this opportunity? Like you said, it's not a bad thing, and would like to make it very clear from the onset,
yes,
that we are not criticizing the opportunity, but we are exploring means and ways of ensuring that it is actually an opportunity that will not only bring money at the expense of your life.
Exactly.
Are there modalities?
Well, perfect. You put it very well. So let me just also just add to what you've said in terms of how that system works. So basically, the way our colleagues, the way things are organized there is that if you are looking for a maid from another country, you are going to sponsor
pay for the air
you
ticket.
You pay for the visa.
Visa and everything.
Exactly. You facilitate their passage to come and work for you.
Yeah.
Okay. So the idea is that they've come in your name at your expense. So usually the people who bring those people into the country wouldn't want to let go of them without trying to recover that money. Okay? Now, what that means is simply that it violates human rights, because you as an individual, myself as an individual, I have the right to quit a job today if I wanted to. Okay? Of course, I don't know the agreements that go on, but the challenge has been that the practice has been that if you get in there, you are held. And if you try by all means to, you know, get another job or move to another employer, there are actually penalties. I mean, from the reports that you've read, actually, you could be imprisoned for doing that. And as far as they are concerned in that region, it's okay. Exactly.
It's an accepted law that is backed by their prevailing legal framework.
That's the way it is. Now, when we talk about how can this be mitigated, I'll re-echo your point to say that, look, firstly, I would like you also to understand that there's a lot of unemployment down here. Actually, globally, it's a global issue. So exactly. There's unemployment in poor countries, largely. And migration is one of the answers to high unemployment levels in countries. You know, people could leave your country, go work elsewhere, find a job with the opportunities. Of course, we are saying we are now concerned about the abuse that's out there. But in terms of mitigating, what countries like Ethiopia have done is to go into an agreement with the host country, the destination where you want to send your notes. So they will come up with what they're calling a unified contract, whereby the government of Zambia, you know, actually agrees with the government in the host country to say, look, when our people come, they are going to come through a formal arrangement. And what we're expecting from them is that they're going to be treated well. So what was done in Ethiopia is, in the process of doing that, actually they facilitated some a bit of skills training before people left the country. So, you know, there's a formal arrangement whereby people actually trained in terms of expectation where they are going. You know, they are trained in terms of if there's an embassy, look, if you need help, the embassy is here. So you know, that kind of thing whereby before people leave, there's that formal arrangement between the Zambian government, for example, and whichever country people are going to.
So in our context, and for those of you that are just joining us right now, you can simply get to participate on this particular, you know, program by simply calling in 0974-754719. Let us know what you think about this particular opportunity that, you know, will facilitate the sending of 1,000 youths to their Gulf nations to work as maids, drivers, waiters, and waitresses. Now, you've mentioned something very valid. You know, I love the fact that, you know, we have examples of countries entering into agreement to protect their citizens, you know, in as much as they are being empowered. Now, I recall the Minister of Information mentioning that there is an agency that expressed interest to extend this particular opportunity to a country like Zambia. So here you're not dealing with the government, you're dealing with an agency. And there have been reports on the ground that when these agencies facilitate these recruitments to these particular regions, when you reach there, as you said, because of this same sponsorship system, they'll confiscate their visa. They'll literally leave you without any document. And you know that certain jurisdictions, it's very difficult to actually get out if you don't have any documentation to prove probably who you claim to be, you know. And it also raises a question of how you got in and things like that. So do you think that it is safer if we deal with an agency and not a government-to-government relationship?
Let me first also make the point that this challenge is actually not unique to Zambia. Globally, I mean, it's not only Zambia that wants to send people to South Africa. Surrounding countries, you know, even Western Europe and the countries nearby there, East Asia, do send their people to those countries. So the problem is actually well known. Institutions like the International Labour Organization have actually been trying to engage with the governments in those countries at that level to ensure that, look, the minimum human rights protection is observed. So, unfortunately, you know, another issue which is here, Wenson, is how do people find themselves in those places? Some people use backdoors. You know, some people go on their own. But we are talking about a government facilitator. So what I would hope for is actually not to work through an agency, but those diplomatic relationships with these governments, if we have an embassy in those places, I think there has to be, you know, a government should interact at that level. I mean, these are Zambian citizens. The concern should be shown by actually, you know, stepping up from the agency to government, say, look, our people are coming. International concerns are ABCD about abuse of workers here. Can we go into a government-to-government agreement to ensure that our people are protected?
Valid points over there. And the other issue, you know, that you mentioned is East Asia.
Mm.
You know, and in East Asia, obviously, you have countries that... Okay, so we've got a caller who was chosen to conceal her identity because she claims to have experienced a bit of what we're talking about.
Okay.
You're through to Biz Week. Good evening. Mwacho mabwanji. Mungatuze ko contribution yanu pa program ino.
Yeah, mwacho mabwanji.
Aifeta choma chabe buino, stizba imwe. Hello? So tuuze and contribution yan.
Yeah.
Tipemba ko mungazimi yako TV so that tikaziku mverani buino na imu mstimvera buino kwa mene muliri.
Yeah, nisina kupamba kupari program yem.
Okay, we've lost that caller over there. But please, if you're watching us right now, kindly ensure that you turn off the volume on your TV set as you get to participate on this very pertinent cardinal topic. As you can see, we have people that have experiences, and those are the experiences that we would love to know so that we can actually get to validate some of the points and the sense that we're discussing on this particular juncture. So we were talking about East Asia and, you know, there are countries like Indonesia, Cambodia, Philippines. These are countries that are relatively not doing well compared to countries like Singapore, you know, which are economically, you know, viable, so to speak. So we have a situation where these countries do also export, okay, labor in form of maids, drivers, waiters, and waitresses to countries like Singapore. And some of them have actually gone to the Gulf nations as well. And they've experienced these things that we are laboring on. Now, Indonesia, for example, has been able to benefit significantly, you know, because they have a system where these people were sent. Okay, we've got Patrick Kabanda before I continue from Ndola.
Sure.
You're through to Biz Week, Mr. Kabanda. Good evening, Mr. Kabanda.
Good evening.
You are through to Biz Week. What is your contribution?
My contribution is I'm against the idea of sending people abroad, especially to those guys who are not learned enough. They are going to just exploit such people. You know, they take them there. They do not have, I'd say,
Okay.
And then they can do anything to them. And then looking at the government that has been at now, government here in Zambia, they do not have that confidence so that they can fight for their people. We need to check and justice. Quite sure some of them, but they can win. But the majority are going to be suffering. Why can't they start thinking about the people from the university? They take people to school, and then later on, people who are educated, people who have got a certain qualification, they have the confidence in whatever they are doing. They take them that side. Unlike they start thinking about some men. Some of them,
thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Kabanda, for that valid contribution. You know, due to the interest of time, we have to move on. But very valid points from
yes.
Mr. Kabanda, you know.
Yes.
Why doesn't government consider sending the literate? Because in this particular part of the world, you know, the majority of the people in the domestic sectors normally you know, their literacy levels are not as advanced as maybe you would have in a different jurisdiction. What are your thoughts on that as we, you know, approach
quickly,
the conclusion?
Yeah, quickly, two things. Firstly, there's demand for maids, drivers, waiters and waitresses. That's a demand that is. And, I mean, these are the people they're requesting for. Exactly. They're not requesting for engineers. I mean, perhaps if they did, engineers would go. But number two is that you and I are like professionals. I mean, you can apply for a job anywhere you want. A maid cannot.
Interesting remarks. So we were talking about the issue of Eastern Europe and, you know, Eastern Asia, creating modalities to ensure that the revenue that they earn in those particular jurisdictions is channeled back home for investment. Has that been taken care of in this particular possible arrangement between government and the Gulf nations?
You know, I wouldn't say it has. And I'm going to broaden this a bit. So actually, you know, what this debate has brought about is quite a number of issues. One of them is the relationship of Zambia and the diaspora. Our Zambian citizens who are working out there, how easy is it for them to send money here, to invest back here? Zambia has for some time been working on a diaspora policy. Because, you see, this issue, what it has raised is that we are actually lacking a system. Some of the worries people have is because we are lacking a system of connecting properly with the Zambians that are working abroad. Are they able to invest back home? So if we send maids, for example, how easy is it for them to send money back here? How cheap is it? And how possible is it that while out there, they can buy land here? Once and quickly, I've worked outside the country before. Mm-hmm. And trust me, sometimes no matter how much money you make outside, just to do an investment back home is very difficult. You take 5 years, you come back, and all that kind of stuff. So there isn't that process. I would take advantage of this opportunity and just appeal to government that we need a diaspora policy in place. Because our colleagues that are Zambians who are working abroad, whether maids or whichever kind of occupation they are in, they are looking back home. So we must make it easier for them to send money, easier for them to invest here if they want, easier for them to buy land if they want. Currently, we don't have access.
Valid points that you've raised, Felix, over there. And I know that certain jurisdictions have actually created deliberate policies to make it very difficult for migrants who are working in those, you know, countries to send money back home because they want to return that money.
Yes.
Therefore, it does bring the need for government to ensure that as they negotiate for these particular opportunities to bring such chips on the table to ensure that at the end of the day, not only will those countries gain the labor force that will supply, but as a country will also be able to gain from the revenue part. As we get to the close of this particular segment, Felix, the requirements are between the ages of 25 to 40. Mm. Now, this is the productive age of the economy.
Yes.
I know that currently Japan is struggling because
this
particular bracket of its population is not as numerous as it is supposed to be. And that has a threat on the country's production capacity, no matter the infrastructure advantage it may have. So do you think that as Zambia, we are still safe?
Safe in terms of?
In terms of giving out the productive age of our population, as we claim to have a 2030 target of making Zambia a middle-income prosperous nation that would require those energetic young people to be here.
Well, firstly, the reason why we are even thinking of sending people out there is because at home here, we have a problem of unemployment. Okay, Zambia is one of the countries in Africa experiencing what we call a youth bout. So you have so many young people moving into their productive ages. Unfortunately, there aren't so many jobs for all of them to be accommodated. So, I mean, it's global. Space will be found out there. But I would say we are very safe.
Okay. So in less than a minute, Felix, finally, what are your recommendations as government looks to seal this deal as we get to close the program?
Three recommendations. The first one is that I know we are implementing our policies to create jobs at home. I think we need to step up on those so that first, before we send, we employ our own. The second one is that we need to strengthen skills development. Mr. Kabanda raised a very important point. Why are we not sending university graduates out there? Okay, so because usually, you know, international migration literature is that it's better to send more skilled people because there are more things to benefit, like they'll come and do the skills transfer. The third one actually is that the diaspora policy.
It's always
Thank
a
you
pleasure
so
to have you, of course.
Sure.
So you've been watching this week, and today we're looking at labor export within the circumference of the pending deal between government and the Gulf nations concerning the sending of 1,000 youths to go and work as drivers, maids, waiters, and waitresses. And we're looking at various aspects that surround these particular opportunities, and that is threats and opportunities at the same time. This is Winston Mavoro. Thank you for watching this.